Ephesians 4, beginning in verse 17. Please hear and listen and follow along as I read from God's holy, inspired word. The word of God says, "Now this I say and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, due to the hardness of heart. They have become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to practice every kind of impurity. But that is not the way you learn Christ. Assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him as the truth is in Jesus, to put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life, and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, having put away falsehood, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another." The word of God for us this morning. While we've been slowly starting to make our way through this passage in Ephesians chapter 4 and 5 that speaks to us about how to live the Christian life. So often that is our question. We have come to the Lord Jesus Christ by faith. We have believed in the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're now saved. We celebrate that. We've celebrated that this morning in the various hymns that we've chosen to sing. We sung of Amazing Grace. We celebrated the reality that Jesus indeed is mine, as the hymn writer says. And we celebrated so much more in that as we read the Word of God and as we pray the Word of God together, that we indeed are in Christ by faith. But there's that lingering question of now what? How do I now live the Christian life? And that's what we're starting to look at in this passage in Ephesians chapter 4 and 5. We began looking at the forest last week, going through the entirety of Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17 to 5, verse 21. And this week we begin to look at the trees. We want to delve deep into these various things that the Word of God tells us that now as Christians, now as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, there are things that ought not to be characteristic of us anymore. These things were characteristic of our former way of living. These things were characteristic of our former life. But now in the Lord Jesus Christ, we want to put these things off. And this imagery that Paul gives to us of putting off, this imagery is of that of changing clothing. It's of taking off an old, dirty, ratty shirt filled with holes and not washed in a long time. We're taking that off, we're putting it aside, and we're taking this new, fresh clothing, and we're putting it on. And all of this is for the end goal. You see in verse 24 towards the end, you're putting on the new self, which is created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. We'll have more to say about that. But the essence of your sanctified life, the essence of your Christian life, is that the Spirit of God is making you into the image of Jesus. We sung of grace, as I mentioned this morning, we sung of grace this morning, and we celebrate the saving grace that we have in Jesus Christ, but we so often forget sometimes the reality that the grace that saves us is the very same grace that is intended to transform us. God did not merely save us from our sins in order that he might leave us there, but he saved us from our sins so that he might transform us. We often articulate this sometimes as being saved by the penalty of sin, and then being saved by from the power of sin. And what we find in Ephesians 4 and 5 are practical ways to work out our Christian life as the Holy Spirit brings transformation into our life and saves us from the power of sin and transforms us into the image of our Lord and Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And in terms of being very practical, Paul gives us this practical three-step process in verses 22 to 24, namely that we're to put off the old self, we're to be renewed in the spirit of our minds, and we're to put on the new self. Now, it doesn't often boil down to be that simple within the Christian life, so long as we still struggle to put off sin. This ends up being more of a cycle than a straightforward process, but it's something that the Christian is proactively working at, putting off the old self, proactively renewing their mind in the Word of God, in the gospel of Jesus Christ, and in the reality of the consequences of their sins, both those sins which were laid on the Lord Jesus Christ, but even the practical consequences that still exist in life now. And as we renew our mind in what the will of God is, we put on the new self so that we might be conformed into the likeness of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so we want to actively be putting off, renewing our minds and putting on. Well, this morning we want to talk about that in terms of falsehood and truth. That's the first thing that Paul mentions in verse 25, insofar as putting off and putting on, having put away falsehood, let each one speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. And so Paul is calling us here in this text, the Word of God is calling us here in this text as redeemed sinners who are now saints in the Lord Jesus Christ. Falsehood ought no longer to be characteristic of our lives, but rather speaking the truth with one another, for we are members of one another. Well, I'd like to consider these three steps with you in turn, and I'd like to begin with you this morning in verse number 25, considering with you putting off falsehood. You notice that there at the beginning of verse 25, Paul says, "Therefore, having put away falsehood." Now, you'll notice that Paul is not so much issuing a command here as he's providing a description of the Christian. Throughout Ephesians, he's been telling us what we were like. For example, chapter 2, verse 1, "And you were," notice that, "you were dead in your trespasses and sins in which you once walked." This is not who you are, this is who you were. "But now you are no longer dead in your trespasses and sin," but middle of chapter 2, verse 5, "you have been made alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved." Now, what are the implications of this? Well, simply this. Notice chapter 4, verse 17, "Because this is what you were and not who you now are, you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their minds." And so there's the imperative. There's the command for us. Since you no longer are a slave to sin, but are alive in Christ, you must become who you are in the Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, verse 25, in light of this, as a consequence of this, you ought to have put away falsehood from your life and practice. The absence of falsehood ought to be characteristic of you. Formerly, you were prone to telling lies. Formerly, you were prone to believing lies. But that ought to all have been put away now. And wherever you see falsehood still reigning in your life, you must put that away also. You see Paul's description here in verse 25, though it's a description, it has the force of a command, of an imperative, which is why if you have a translation like the NIV in front of you, your translation reads, "Each of you must put off falsehood." Why? Because you're not a Gentile anymore. Now you're saved. Now you're in Christ. Now you're a Christian. And as a Christian, you ought not to be characterized by falsehood. Put away falsehood. What does that mean? Well, to begin with, it means that you need to stop telling lies. Lies are characteristic of the old self. You aren't that person anymore. You've been made alive in Christ. And as a Christian who is a follower after the Lord Jesus Christ and who is becoming like the Lord Jesus Christ, you need to stop telling lies. Are you tracking with this? Is it clear to you? Lying is sinful. Sometimes we don't think so. It was just a little white lie. But God's word tells us that lying is sinful. Lying denigrates the Lord Jesus Christ. Lying hurts those around you. How many relationships have been poisoned by lies? How many churches have been utterly obliterated by lies? That's why we read Acts chapter 5 this morning, Ananias and Sapphira, and the seriousness with which God takes lying within the local church and certainly within life. And in case it's not clear yet, Paul says it even more clear in Colossians 3, verse 9, saying, "Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have put off the old self with its practices." Christian, you need to stop lying. Now, there are many ways in which we tell lies. We're quite creative at how we tell lies. We've, as human beings, have perfected the lying process, haven't we? There's open deception, just flat out lying. We see this in Genesis chapter 3, where Satan flat out lied to Eve. "Surely you will not die when you eat this." What was that? That was a lie. That was open deception. There's secret deception. Jacob went to his father having put on his brother's clothing and his brother's smell so that he might steal his father's blessing from his older brother. It was a lie. There's manipulation which takes all sorts of shapes and forms. It comes in the form of flattery. There's people who flatter those around them with the intention of either manipulating or deceiving the person they're flattering. And there's preying on people's emotions with dishonest intent. You want something from someone, and instead of just asking for what you need, you try to manipulate them into doing what you want. I wonder if you've ever tried to manipulate someone before. Do you remember Luke chapter 10 when Jesus was visiting with Mary and Martha? Martha was doing all the kitchen work, and Mary was sitting in the other room at the feet of Jesus. And rather than simply asking for assistance or saying to Jesus, "Would you mind excusing my sister for a moment?" she goes up to him and says, "Lord, do you not care?" I mean, can you just hear the manipulation there? She's attempting to prey on Jesus' emotions. "Do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Tell her to help me." She wasn't honest enough to just say what she needed. Instead, she tried to manipulate. There's silence. You can deceive people with your silence. That is, withholding critical information that would be needed in order to understand the truth. You're doing it to deceive. There's spin. Presenting information in a very particular way in order to misdirect people from the truth. Well, you know, technically I told you the whole truth. But there's spin. That spin is meant to deceive. Newspapers and news channels are professionals at this. There was an online article published by CBC on April 13th, 2020, and it had the headline, "Scheer and Family Joined Other MPs on packed flight to Ottawa, ignoring social distancing rules. Oh my. Now, if you know anything about online media, many people just read the headline and keep scrolling. And so if the headline was all you read, all you would know is that former conservative leader Andrew Scheer boarded a packed airplane, not social distancing at the height of COVID. Oh my. What you don't know, unless you read the article, is this so-called packed airplane was a 9-seater. 7 of the 9 seats were taken up by Scheer, his wife, and their 7 children. And the other 2 seats were taken up by a Liberal MP and the leader of the Green Party, who had to approve the flight before taking off. And the plane itself was chartered by the office of the Prime Minister. What is that? That's spin. It technically included all that information, but the headline, Scheer boards packed airplane, it's dishonest. There's exaggeration. Exaggeration is a form of lying. It's adding information in order, or adding emphasis in order to, here it is again, to manipulate the truth and to deceive people. Politicians have perfected this. They're experts at it. Isn't it amazing? Look at all the different ways there is to tell lies. And this is just a brief survey of it. And yet God's word is saying to each one of us this morning that all of this, the open deception, the secret deception, the manipulation, whether through flattery or preying on people's emotions, the silence, the spin, the exaggeration, all of these are characteristics of the old self. And like changing a shirt, you need to put all of this off. Christians, do not tell lies. Stop lying. Put away falsehood. Well, not only does putting off falsehood mean stop telling lies, but also it means stop believing lies. Believing lies is characteristic of the old self, and you need to put that off. Notice back in verse 17, Paul describes the Gentile or the unbeliever as one who has a futile mindset. Notice towards the end of verse 18 that they are ignorant due to the hardness of their heart. Notice also when Paul tells us, verse 22, to put off your old self, it is that which belongs to your former manner of life. It is corrupt through deceitful desires. Paul gives a very similar description of the Gentile unbeliever in Romans chapter 1, and in verse 25 of that chapter, he explains the reason for their futile mindset and for their ignorance. It is because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie. Unbelievers, by definition, is someone who doesn't believe the truth. They believe in a lie. As an unbeliever, you believe lies. Agnostics believe the lie that there's really no way to know if there's a God. Secularists believe the lie that it doesn't matter if there's a God. Pluralists believe the lie that there's more than one God. Jews and Muslims believe the lie that while there is only one God, he does not consist of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. At one time, we all believed the lie that we're not sinners separated from God, or that Jesus is not Lord of all, or that we do not need to be saved, or that we're too far gone to be saved, or maybe that we can save ourselves by doing good. Muhammad Ali famously once said, "I just want to get to heaven, and I've got to do a lot of good deeds to get there." He was believing a lie. But listen, you're not an unbeliever anymore. And so you need to give up believing in lies. Listen, Paul says, verse 20, That is not the way you learned Christ. You're not ignorant anymore because you learned Christ. Verse 21, you have heard about him and were taught in him as the truth is in Jesus. You're not ignorant anymore because you have heard and you have been taught and you have learned the truth, which is in the Lord Jesus Christ. Indeed, he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And so if by faith you have come to Jesus, you need to stop believing lies. Paul says in verse 25, therefore, having put away falsehood, as a believer, that's something you've done when you've come to Jesus. You've put it away. Sadly, though, like cleaning a house, sometimes the house simply doesn't want to stay clean. At least mine doesn't. Many of you know what I'm talking about, though. You still have those thoughts. I'm worthless. I'm unloved. God is against me. I'm probably not even a real Christian. I've got to do better for God to save me. I wonder if you've ever thought those thoughts before. You have those false thoughts, and they mire you down, and they with guilt and shame, and they bring depression upon you and despair. And if that's you, I want to say to you this morning, I'm so sorry, you're not alone. Many Christians have struggled with their thoughts before. But I want to say to you this morning, on the authority of God's word and in the name of Jesus Christ, who laid down his life for sins, those are lies. And you don't have to believe them anymore. As Christians trusting in the finished work of the Lord Jesus, you've put away those lies. And you need to keep putting away those lies by continuing to cling to Christ. And so stop telling lies. Stop believing in lies. Put away falsehood. Second, you want to renew your mind. That's the second step which Paul refers to in verse 23. You want to be renewed in the spirit of your minds. You might say this takes place after putting off, but that's actually not right. This is what you want to be doing all throughout the putting off and putting on process. That's what you're doing this morning as you sing together, as you pray together, as you hear from the Word of God. We together are proactively renewing our minds in the truth of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ. And we've talked about this, previously before. There's always at the outset, this involves renewing our mind in God's Word. This comes from reading the Word of God. This comes from internalizing the Word of God. This comes from listening to the Word of God read out. Remember Psalm 119, verse 9. How can a young man keep his way pure? By guarding it according to your word. Verse 11, I have stored up your word in my heart, that I might not sin against you. As you guard your hearts and minds with the word, and as you store up that word, you renew your mind so that you might be able to discern God's will for your life. That is, after all, how Paul says it in Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what the will of God is, what is good and acceptable and perfect. So many people are asking today, what is God's will for my life? And what they usually mean is, who should I marry? What career path should I take? How many children should I have? When should I retire? There's practical ways in which you can discern this through prayer, through community, through conversation, through contemplation. But ultimately, the Bible tells us that there's certain things that aren't revealed to us. Deuteronomy 29, verse 29, the secret things belong to the Lord our God. You can't always know the answers to these questions. Why? Because the secret things belong to the Lord our God. But the verse goes on to say, but the things that are revealed are that we may do all the words of this law. Sometimes we spend so much time trying to know the secret things of God that we forget that God has revealed things already in His Word. God has prescribed things for us already. And it's revealed to us so that we might obey Him. And so then, what is God's will for your life? What is God's will for my life? Let me just give you one example. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 22. Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord. Tell me, does it get any clearer than that? God's will for your life is that you would stop lying. But listen, the verse doesn't end there. It says, lying lips are an abomination to the Lord, but those who act faithfully, those who act truthfully, are His delight. Now, I'm not saying that you need to earn His delight in the sense of earning His favor, in the sense of earning your salvation. We've already failed at that, and that's why we need Jesus. And if you're not a Christian this morning, the first step is to abandon all hope in yourself and abandon all hopes in any alternative that you might be looking to and look to Jesus Christ. But having looked to Jesus Christ, what I'm saying here is for those of us living in the light of the cross of Jesus and in the power of the Holy Spirit, when you hear that God delights in those who are truthful, doesn't that excite you? Do you not feel anything when you hear that? Wouldn't you like to know that God isn't appalled by what you're doing when you speak to this person or that person, but He delights in it? How would renewing your mind in what God delights in transform how you behave? Think on that. Meditate on that. Let that wash over you. And as you renew your mind in God's Word, do not forget to renew your mind in the gospel. Remind yourself of your new identity in Christ. Once again, verse 20 and 21 speaks to how you have heard and have been taught and have learned the truth about Jesus Christ. And isn't it interesting that in virtually every letter of the Apostle Paul, he never says, this is what you should do. Rather, he starts with the gospel. This is the gospel. This is who you once were, and this is who you now are in Christ. And now knowing that, having reflected on that, having renewed your mind in that, you need to go and live in light of the gospel and in light of your new identity in Christ. What is the end goal of the gospel? What is the end goal of our sanctification? We've said it already. It's that we might look like Jesus. In a moment, we're going to look at the putting on part. But notice again, chapter 4, verse 24, that the new self is created after the likeness of God. Very similarly, Colossians 3:10, the new self is being renewed in the knowledge after the image of its creation. That's how sanctification works. How might we look more like Jesus then? Well, as we reflect on Jesus, the Son of God, who is the truth, and the truth is in Jesus, as we reflect on that, that ought to change us, that ought to transform us. As we read things like Titus chapter 1, verse 2, where Paul tells us that God never lies. So if the new self is created after the image of God, as verse 24 tells us, then in order to look more like God, in order to look more like His Son, you need to put off falsehood. As God's grace transforms you and begins to conform you into the image of his Son, you'll stop lying and you'll stop believing lies. And so isn't it telling then that Satan would work so extremely hard to distract you from God's word and from your identity in Christ? He wants to distract you in order to deprogram you and to indoctrinate you in the ways of the world instead. After all, John 8:42 tells us that he is the father of lies. But as you reflect on the gospel and as you reflect upon your new identity in Christ, remember that you're not a Gentile anymore. You're in Christ. You have the Holy Spirit inside helping you, and in that power, you need to resist the devil and put away falsehood. And so we're renewing our minds in God's word. We're renewing our minds in the gospel and in our new identity in Christ. But then we read these words at the end of verse 25. For we are members one of another. Paul puts that there to motivate us. Paul puts that there as a truth for us to renew our minds in. We're to renew our minds also in membership. Isn't it interesting that when confronting Saul for persecuting the church, that Jesus doesn't say, "Why are you persecuting the church?" He says, "Why are you persecuting me?" Christ was referring to the reality that when he saves individuals, he joins them to the body of which he is the head. And what you need to realize is that your sin as a Christian does so much more than hurt you. It does so much more than stunt your own growth, but the growth of those around you. And what God's word tells us this morning is that spreading lies and spreading disbelief will destroy the church. Lies destroy the church witness from the outside. Lies hurts your brothers and sisters from the inside. Don't ever think that your lies have no consequences on the people around you. Lies always have consequences. Sometimes we think it doesn't matter. I'm not hurting anybody. Even that is a lie. Tell me, have you ever heard of the little boy who cried wolf? His lies had consequences on the community. He kept lying by saying there was a wolf when there really wasn't one. And then when finally the wolf comes, no one believes him and there is disaster. Well, how often do lies absolutely destroy the local church, whether it's spreading lies by speaking them or by believing the lies that have been spoken? In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 17 and 18, Paul mentions two people, Hymenaeus and Philetus, who would do great damage to the church in Ephesus. And that is because they have swerved from the truth. You see, they were telling people that the final resurrection had already happened, and they were upsetting people's faith. And it was upsetting people's faith because it was a lie. It wasn't true. But even worse, Paul says, their talk will spread like gangrene throughout the church. And gangrene, that's just an awful infection in your body that just begins to spread all over and eat at your flesh. And that's what falsehood does within the church. Whether it comes from telling lies or believing lies, ultimately it will spread and it will spread and it will spread until it's infected the entire church. And God's word is calling you here this morning not only to look after your own spiritual health, though you should, but to look beyond yourself and to consider the church around you, your brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ. And as you renew your mind to the reality that your lies really do hurt people, that your lies really do affect people around you, that ought to motivate you to put lying away. Put away falsehood. For we are members of one another. How do we do that then? Having now renewed our minds in the truth, how do we put off falsehood? Well, let me ask it this way. How does a caterpillar become a butterfly? Or let me put it a different way. When does a caterpillar stop being a caterpillar? So often we talk about our sanctification that way, and it's really unhelpful and it doesn't work. A caterpillar is not a caterpillar no longer because he stops being a caterpillar, but because he becomes a butterfly. When is a liar no longer a liar? Not when he stops lying. A liar is no longer a liar when he becomes a truth teller. The two go hand in hand. And so if you want to put off falsehood, you have to do more than simply stop telling lies, stop believing lies. You have to actively speak the truth. And that's exactly what Paul says here, Ephesians 4:25. Notice, therefore, having put away falsehood, notice, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Neighbor here refers simply to a member of the community, and certainly it would be a very good thing for you to speak the truth with your neighbors, with your family members, with your co-workers, with your unbelieving friends. But here Paul's been speaking more specifically about the body of Christ. He's speaking of we who are members one of another. And among the body of Christ, we don't want to spread falsehood like gangrene. We want to spread truth like a pleasant aroma. And on a surface level, speaking the truth means the opposite of lying. And we've said that. If you're going to stop lying, you replace lying with telling the truth. Don't conceal, but reveal. God delights in that. Listen, we're not loving one another if we're not being truthful to one another. Now, maybe it would be a good time to point out Ephesians 4:15, where Paul says, speak the truth in love. I hope you see that. And 1 Corinthians 13:5 says that love is not rude. Woe, Nelly. More than speaking the truth, our intentions need to be in order. Notice the intention we ought to have, verse 15, is so that we all together might grow up in every way to him who is the head, into Christ. And so the manner of our expression and the motivation of our hearts still matter. You're speaking the truth, but you're speaking the truth because you love one another and because you want to build one another up into Christ, who is our head. That's the manner, that's the motivation. But there's a deeper level insofar as to the specific truth that we want to be speaking to one another. Certainly we want to speak the truth more generally, but notice how Paul defines the truth in chapter 1, verse 13. There he says, in him you also, when you heard the word of truth. Now you see the word of truth there. And Paul's about to clarify what the word of truth is. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, which is the gospel of your salvation. What is the truth that Paul has in mind here? It is the gospel. So when Paul says, speak the truth with your neighbor, fundamentally he means have gospel conversations with one another. We need to speak the gospel to each other. We need to speak in light of the gospel to one another. We need to sing the gospel to one another. Colossians 3:16, let the word of Christ or the gospel of Christ dwell in you richly so that you might be able to teach and admonish one another with singing of psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. You see, we need our brothers and sisters in Christ to help remind us of what is true. And that's where that maturity comes from in chapter 4, verses 15 and 16. Once more, rather speaking the truth in love, we're to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. Paul says speaking the truth in love, he's not saying you just need to tell people hard things, but make sure you're loving when you do it. But what Paul means, he's saying speaking the truth in love is that we're having gospel conversations. Our conversations are richly woven with gospel threads. In other words, we're not just talking to each other about the weather or family or sports or work or sickness or vacation, though we talk about all those things, but we're talking about them in light of the gospel. We're seeking to bring the truth of God's love in Christ to bear on every aspect of our lives. Listen, we need each other, Paul's saying. We need each other to help live our lives in light of the truth. And that's what chapter 4, verse 25 means in all of its fullness when it says, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor. What are some practical ways in which we might speak the truth with our neighbor? What are some practical ways that we might even do this morning? You might ask one another, how is your relationship with God? And depending on the response, you might help one another come to realize truth in that moment. You might help bring truth to bear in that moment. Whether someone's struggling in their relationship with God, you bring truth to bear. When somebody is doing very well in their relationship with God, you praise God in light of the truth. You might ask one another, what does the Bible say about this? And you might speak about that. You might open up your Bibles together to know the truth. What are some other ways you might employ truth-telling? You might employ truth-telling in writing notes, letters, text messages, emails, to encourage one another in the truth, to remind one another of the truth. You might do it verbally through a phone call. Or how about instead of just saying you'll pray for someone, that you actually pray for them in that moment? You can encourage them in the truth by praying with them. Let me ask you this morning, are you a Christian who's given to lies and deception and falsehood? Do you struggle in speaking the truth? You need to recognize that about yourself. You need to be honest about what you're doing. You need to confess that to the Lord, and you need to ask for his grace to become a person who puts away falsehood and who speaks the truth. Are you a Christian who's believing lies and falsehoods this morning? Are you an unbeliever who's believing lies and falsehoods this morning? You need to turn away from those lies that the world has fed you and turn to the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, who gave his life for you. And you've been reminded of that great truth in the gospel this morning, that Jesus died and has covered your sins and God has set his love on you. And all of us need to think about speaking the truth with one another in our conversations with each other so that we're not merely having small talk, but that we're building one another up in the Lord Jesus Christ by speaking the truth in love. May we be a people, a truth-embracing people, a truth-speaking people this morning, because God is going to use that to build us up. And so, having put away falsehood, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members one and another. And God help us for Christ's sake. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we praise you for the truth that is in Jesus Christ. We praise you for the truth that is revealed through your inspired word. We praise you for the truth that you have revealed to us through the power of the Holy Spirit. We praise you for the truth that Our sins are paid for in Jesus Christ, and we pray, Lord, that you would empower us now to live in light of that truth and to live as a people of truth and to conform us more into the image of Christ, who is the truth. We pray that you would forgive us for our lying and for our doubt. We pray, Lord, that you would continue to encourage and build us up in the truth, not only individually, but together. I pray, Lord, that you would remind us that when we lie, that we are not hurting ourselves only, but that we're hurting one another. I pray, Lord, that you would protect our church from telling lies and from believing in lies, that you would protect our church from falsehood, and that you would build us up together into our head, who is the Lord Jesus Christ, in and through the truth. So we praise you for the truth. We pray that you would be honored as we come together in just a moment to sing the truth of the gospel. And we do all of this in the name of our Lord and Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.